When I got done with Desert Storm, okay, we were in combat, okay, so we had to go through psychiatric debriefing. So I went through it was the military, so they're moving you pretty quick. So the psychiatrist, he really did personally, he goes, okay, Belinsky, tell me what you feel like, but use inanimate objects. And I said, sir, sometimes I feel like a teepee. And I said, sometimes I feel like a wigwam. And he goes, okay, well, you know what your problem is? He said, you're too tense. That's not bad. Okay, wait. You didn't give me a chance on the delivery of the mushroom. I'm going to deliver the mushroom joke tomorrow. It's going to be much better. Psych. Okay, so what are the green lights? Anxiety disorders, depressive disorders. Makes sense. We got to know about anxious people and depressed people, and that makes sense. Now, some of the yellow lights, like post-traumatic stress, substance use disorder, suicide. We got to have first-line treatments, guys. We have to know about when someone comes in and they're abusing their body with drugs and alcohol, or someone comes in and says, listen, I'm thinking of committing suicide. We got to know first-line treatment, not details. First-line treatment. Cool. There's five types of anxiety: general anxiety, obsessive compulsive, panic, phobias, and PTSD. So general anxiety disorder, a nervous Nelly. Someone just always a little bit nervous. It affects their ADLs. Just they're nervous. They're kind of jumpy and anxious. Excessive worry and anxiety that's difficult to control. It causes significant distress and impairment. It occurs on more days than not. At least more days than not, at least last 6 months. So this is a 6 month kind of thing. The main objective of the treatment is to reduce symptoms of anxiety and therefore increase functioning. The normal demographics, 20-year-old female, fatigue, lack of focus, concentration, restless irritability, that's what we're looking for. Now, when someone has just a general anxiety disorder, we try medicines, SSRIs, and cognitive behavioral therapy. So SSRIs, or the serotonin, norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors. Now, a general rule, benzodiazepines. Here's the rule. Benzos are alert. They're controlled substances. The terminology from the NCCPA that I've heard many times is short course and tapered. Short course and tapered. Short course and tapered. If you're going to use them, short course and tapered, it's addictive. We don't want to get people addicted. Okay, we'll talk about anxiety disorder, about how benzos can actually create more of a problem than a good coping mechanism. The SSRIs and the SNRIs, slightly different variations, but overall SSRIs are a first-line agent. Just know that they can take between 3 and 6 weeks to really hit optimal neurotransmitter levels and work. And during that time, the benzos may be a helpful bridge. So the SSRIs and SNRIs. Now, first and foremost, there's lots of non-specific stuff that can happen with these meds. So between headache, nausea, vomiting, sexual dysfunction, weight change, look at the blue highlight. We have to warn them. If you have any concerns about suicidal ideations, you need to stop the medicine and call me. That has to be a communicated conversation, something you document in your notes. What's that? It was my understanding it's with everybody, but can anybody compliment? So my colleague who does psych in the back, or say again? If it's me, I'm telling everybody about it. That's going to be a conversation, a documentation that I'm having. Now, just know sexual dysfunction, Prozac over Celexa, and then Cymbalta over Paxil. Keep it in mind. Look at the yellow highlights. Now, what is serotonin syndrome? Watch me for a second. Serotonin syndrome is someone who started SSRI and they kind of present like this. They kind of have this kind of similar to neuroleptic malignant syndrome, kind of similar to a blood transfusion reaction, kind of. Agitation, confusion, changes, diarrhea, nausea. Bottom line is, if you start someone SSRI and they get these weird body movements, you got to think serotonin syndrome. Symptomatic treatment, take them off the medicine. It's potentially life-threatening. Obsessive compulsive disorder. Now, let's talk about obsessions. What is an obsession? An obsession is an unwanted intrusive thought. Now, when you have an obsession, you don't want it, but it keeps popping in your head. Now, here's what happens. It builds up pressure, and then you do your compulsion. And it creates a cycle. Now, listen, obsessive compulsive disorder. That D stands for dystonic. They're ego dystonic. What do you mean by that, John? Obsessive compulsive disorder, they're ego dystonic. They don't like this. They don't want this. They don't want this in their life. They just can't stop it. That's different than obsessive compulsive personality disorder. They're ego syntonic. All personality disorders, screw you. Don't tell me to change. You go screw yourself. Personality disorders is, hey, don't tell me to change. I'm good with this. like your narcissists, like your histrionics, like your antisocials. Don't tell, screw you, don't tell me to change. Obsessive compulsive disorder, they don't want this, they just can't stop it. Okay, whether it's drinking, alcohol, shopping, sex, gambling, okay? Obsessions, unwanted intrusive thoughts, repetitive thoughts, images or urges that cause marked stress or anxiety. Obsessions often involve content that's as odd, irrational, seemingly magical in nature, like harm will come from them if their closet's not arranged in a specific order. Now, individuals with obsessive compulsive disorder, they mitigate their symptoms to the obsession with another thought or behavior. That's your compulsion. Like I had a lady who was admitting her to the psych unit at Niagara Falls Memorial, and she was cutting herself, self-mutilating. Nothing needed sutures, but she was, you know, going through some real struggles. And her husband was in the room like, why are you doing so much? I'd be home, and I'd be thinking my husband, he wasn't here, and I have all these nerves, and then I cut myself, and I'd feel better. But then I get anxious because I cut myself. And then there's these multiple cuts. Okay, obsessive compulsive disorder. And my experience with psych, first third of my career, I hated psych. I didn't want, like, people would come in with psychiatric problems. I'm like, come on, I want heart attacks and stroke. And then what I realized is as I got a little bit older, we all got something. Yeah. We all got something. It could be in that book, okay? The compulsion or rituals, repetitive behavior, mental acts, could be counting, repeating words silently. These acts reduce the stress from the obsession. While compulsions are often related to the obsession, like washing hands if you're fear of contagious nature, sometimes there's no relationship whatsoever. They're often not connected at all, and or at least in any realistic way that makes any logical sense. So examples, like this may be arranging items in a symmetrical order to prevent harm to a loved one, or showering for several hours to avoid an illness. So bottom line is, the obsessions build up anxiety, the compulsion mitigates it. They could be correlated or not. Now, obsessive compulsive disorder, they're ego dystonic. Time out, guys. When someone has a behavior, remember how I talked about this question? I said, what's more important to change a behavior, need or want? Want. If you don't want to, you're not going to change it. I don't care what. You might need to lose weight. You might need to control your blood sugar. You might need to stop drinking alcohol. But if you don't want to, you're not doing it. Ego dystonic patients, they don't want this, so they're a little more susceptible to help. Just be aware, guys, when anybody, you're concerned about someone's behavior, the most important question is, do you want to stop? Like, seriously, do you want to stop? And if they say, I do want to stop, do you feel you have the power to control this behavior? Do you feel you're powerless, or do you think you're in control of your life? And that's how you start. And I'll just tell you this, that no change is really made until you get to an extreme. You're either going to be obsessed with change or disgusted. If you're lukewarm, nothing happens. Okay? So, obsessive compulsive disorder treatment, cognitive behavioral therapy. And that may be someone you have to refer to counseling. If you don't have some training here, that's not your forte. Plus, it takes a lot of time. Exposure therapy and response prevention. So, bottom line is, we'll talk about exposure therapy, which is very interesting coming up. SSRIs are your first line. So, obsessive compulsive severe symptoms, cognitive behavior therapy, meds, the scale. So there are a couple scales that we can use. The clinical global impression scale, okay? Score above 5 or more would show more severe symptoms. Or this was called the Yale-Brown obsessive compulsive score grading 24, suggests more severe. Now, if they're unwilling to explore cognitive behavioral therapy, they don't wanna go to counseling, you can still try the SSRIs. Okay, it's kind of like with smoking, varenicline, plus some degree of cognitive behavior therapy, if it's a 1-800-QUIT-NOW. If they don't want to call the number, they don't want to do that, okay, we can still start with the meds. That's reasonable. Panic disorders, recurrent unexpected panic attacks. An attack followed by months of persistent concern or worry about another attack or consequences and or maladaptive behavior, such as avoidance. Now, as a general rule, when it comes to panic disorders, let's just say spiders, panic disorder about spiders. Now, well, hold on, that's not a good example. I'm gonna keep rocking with this, but it's not a great example. Is it better to teach avoidance or coping? It's much better than coping because we can't always avoid some of the triggers. And Kyle, just know that when I'm talking about this, yes, we're talking about the boards. Yes, we're talking about patient care, but this, I'm talking about us too, okay? Now, a panic attack, just so you guys know, the reason I didn't quite like my example of the spiders is because that's a specific phobia. Panic disorders are normally unexpected and they don't even know it's going to come on. So normally a panic disorder, it's recurring and unexpected. They don't even know. They don't even have stress, anxiety, but also they get hit with this panic attack. It comes out of nowhere. And a lot of times they really think they're sick. They get palpitations, hypersympathetic. They think they have chest pain, okay? So recurrent, unexpected, intense fear. Now, females about 25 years old, the fear of going outside into public is more common than anything. They get the hypersympathetic symptoms. It's kind of like they have a pheochromocytoma or hyperthyroidism. Chest pain, palpitation, tachycardia, tremor, dizziness, nausea, diaphoresis, this going crazy like sensation, and that happens very rapidly. When they come in, they need a workup. Okay, they're gonna get labs, TSH, tox screen. Now, with panic disorders, first line is SSRI, cognitive behavioral therapy to focus on. Relaxation, desensitization, basically looking at some of the behavioral consequences, acute attacks, benzos. Okay. Now, let's talk about phobias. And when I talked about spiders before, this is more when I was talking about. So I when it comes to panic disorders, these come out of nowhere. Phobias, you kind of know what it is. You have a trigger. So specific phobia, that is an anxiety disorder characterized by fear of a particular object or situation that typically leads to avoidant behavior. Excessive fear that the patient actually realizes. Okay? Types of phobias. I'm going to say this, and then I'm going to ask you guys, what's your phobia? If there's a phobia, what's yours? So, could be animals, insects, heights, water, enclosed spaces, could be driving, flying, could be a choking or vomiting. Some specific phobias include responses to medical procedures, like his injections, dental work, bloods. Okay. Kara, what's your phobia? What are you afraid of? You don't like snakes? No. All right, what's yours? Henry. What's that? Panry. Very good. Panry. NCCPA, listen, you're causing phobias. Any other phobias? Spiders? I think I'm a man's man. I don't like spiders or snakes either. I don't get freaked out about them. I just prefer. What's closed spaces? Okay, when they put that bar down on a merry-go-round or like the roller coaster. What? Height? MRIs. You know what my freaks me out a little bit? I do not like? I'll punch you in your clown face. Get the clown face. I'll punch you in your little buzzy nose. Okay? We went to Blue Man Group last night. We were not impressed. We left early. And they're walking through the audience. I will punch you in your blue. You'll be a blue, black and blue man. Okay? You stay away from me, clowns. Okay? I just don't like clowns. We all got our thing. Okay, now, guys, one of the things that I taught was Dale Carnegie. I taught facilitation for Dale Carnegie. And one of the biggest fears people have is public speaking. And to take people who were very afraid of public speaking and constantly expose them every week to a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more, and then see at the end of 8 weeks, life-changing transformations. What was it? It's exposure therapy. Kara and I was there. There was a guy named Brian. We're doing this $200 million window company. This guy, Brian, was a middle-aged middle manager. And his manager came in and said, listen, one of my employees coming in, he is freaking out. He hates the fact that he's got to come to this. So when this guy, Brian, came in, I knew who he was before he gave his name. So the first day, you're doing a very, very soft talk about who you are and what you do. We're going in the room and I'm waiting for him to because I'm people, you know, you got to get up at your time. So bottom line is it's coming down. There's only a couple people left. You can see him. He's taking off his jacket. You can see the sweat coming down his face and he's doing this. And I'm like, okay, Brian, you ready? And he gets up and you could just see him. He's going to lose it. And I wanted to give him a chance. So then I just got close to him. Okay, just talk to me, brother. We're going to have a conversation. So when I got close to him, he could talk to me. What do you do here? And he could tell me, okay. How long have you been here for? So bottom line is, he just started talking to me and we started carrying a conversation. All of a sudden you could feel his anxiety go down. So as we started just talking, I just started backing away a little bit. So as he started talking, and all of a sudden he's still talking to me, but now he's doing public speaking and he doesn't even quite know it. Okay, Brian, listen, you're doing great, brother. Just look at some of your, like the people now. So now he's talking. Now what we did at Dale Carnegie was, at the end of the talks, the class vote for awards, breakthrough award. Well, he won the breakthrough award that day because he broke through. He did something. Well, next week he came. Was he jacked up the next week? Yeah, but he was better. by the last week, he was a force, and it changed his life. It was exposure therapy, just a little bit. Oh, that wasn't that bad, okay? Now, that's cognitive behavioral therapy. Guys, if you want any class on emotional intelligence or public speaking, take your Dale Carnegie class. Wherever you live, there's going to be an eight-week class. It costs about $2,000. Change your life. It'll change your life. You'll become very strong in multiple areas of your life. So, phobias. Exposure treatment is more effective, 75% than those receiving placebo for 64% of those receiving non-exposure therapy. So basically, exposure therapy works. Now, what do you mean by that? Micro exposures in a safe environment. So cognitive behavioral therapy versus meds. There are no randomized clinical controlled trials that shows cognitive behavioral therapy comparing with meds. There's nothing that compared them. Now, if it's infrequently encountered and unavoidable, possibly benzos. What do you mean by that? Okay, let's just say I hate flying. I can't fly. I don't want to fly. I hate flying. I'm never flying again. Well, good for you. Don't fly. But then there's a death in the family. They got to fly. Okay, Xanax is a 1 milligram. It's very short acting. It's reasonable. It's reasonable. Warning. You want to avoid, listen closely. Listen. You want to avoid med and cognitive behavioral therapy at the same time because it creates a Pavlov's dogs effect. It's almost like people go in a social environment and they're uncomfortable being out, so they drink alcohol. And all of a sudden, they can't go into a bar without drinking alcohol because it's a correlated psychological Pavlov's dogs phenomenon. I found this fascinating. So they had people who were really jacked up. They had an anxiety and a phobia about flying. So here's what they did. 28 females with flying phobia, random aside, either to receive benzo or placebo. So on the very first flight, because they had to do two flights, the first flight, the people got the benzo, had less anxiety. They took a pill. They took a sedative. They didn't even know it, but like, oh, it was okay. Now, the people who got the placebo, they had more anxiety. But you'd imagine that, right? Well, of course, that makes sense. A month later, they do a second flight. Everybody got placebo. So no one got a benzo. Second flight, way more anxiety, less anxiety. So bottom line is because they were exposed, they were better. There's something to this. So what am I saying? All right, well, bottom line is if it's a micro introduction to the person's life, like a flight, okay, we're going to give you benzo. And then that's not unreasonable. But just understand, exposure therapy, at least in this small study, showed benefit. And this makes a lot of sense to me, especially as I taught public speaking, I could see it. Micro doses strengthens people. Oh, that wasn't as bad as I thought. Okay? I love pushing Kara. About 4 or 5 months ago, I said, you're going to do karaoke. I am not doing karaoke. You are not doing karaoke. You're going to do karaoke one night. Well, the one night she got up, and she got up with another girl, but it was the first time ever did. And guess what she did? She, I dug my keys in this door side of that, did a little for you. And she was kind of like, that wasn't too bad. I'm like, well, you did good. Next thing you know, you realize, okay, that wasn't as bad as I thought. I'm not sure she's going to be a karaoke girl, but it wasn't what she thought because she got a little exposure to it. Just a quick question for you. What do you something you're like, hell no, I'm not going to do that. That maybe micro exposure might be good for you. It might help you to break through. Okay.
My friend back here said you should be worried about the choice.
Oh, that's a good point. That's a good point.
Touche.
About to do a combo. What he don't know. How do I treat phobias? Beta blockers. Just know, beta blockers decrease the sympathetic response, right? Whoa, hold on. If someone's hypersympathetic, two things go up and two things dilate. Remember, their blood pressure and their pulse go up and two things out, their pupils. And if we beta blocker, relaxes everybody. And this is not up here, but please remember, guys, if you're really jacked up, what would putting your face in cold water do? It would stimulate the vagus nerve and slow everything down a little bit. Okay. Post-traumatic stress disorder, considerable, consider social, occupational, and interpersonal dysfunction. severe, often chronic, it's disabling time, following exposure, traumatic event. Intrusive thoughts, nightmares and flashes, avoidance of and reminders of the trauma, hypervigilance and sleep disturbances. Now, for you to have post-traumatic stress disorder, it's gotta be going to greater than a month. Fear, helplessness, horror. Men, typically it's combat action, and females, normally some kind of physical assault. So, anhedonia. Now, anhedonia, I feel, is a really important word. Now, what does anhedonia mean? No joy. Lack of joy, and there's no joy. And I don't think I'm ever going to have joy. So, if I have someone, and this is a flag word for suicide, what do you do for fun? There's nothing I do for fun. Come on, there's got to be something you do for fun. There's not. Come on, there's got to be something you enjoy. There's nothing I enjoy. Well, sir, you fish, don't you fish? I gave away all my fishing stuff. I don't fish anymore. Well, sir, don't you see your grandkids? I haven't talked to my daughter in 10 years. I don't see my grandkids. What do you do that you truly enjoy? When they look at you and say, there's absolutely nothing that I do that I enjoy, nor do I perceive it. That's very concerning to me. And that's one of the features of post-traumatic stress disorder, okay? So trauma-focused psychotherapy are preferred treatments. Now, one of the things I want to share with you guys, because I think this is really, I just want to share something with you. I've had a bunch of really bad things happen in the hospital and on ambulances. I was in combat action. I did shoot at people. I did see dead people. I didn't kill anybody. And no one right by me got hit. Okay? But I saw the aftermath of war. And my experiences, it didn't bother me so much. I was okay with it. Like, it didn't bother me. Now, in my immature early phases of being a PA, I thought, wait, I said maybe I'm just tougher than some people. Maybe that, I was actually thinking that. Well, it didn't bother me. And that's kind of what I thought. Maybe post-traumatic stress is maybe for people who aren't as strong as me. And that's what I thought. Okay. It was an afternoon and it was sunny out. So the ER I'm working at, it's quiet. Nothing's going on. I got nobody in the ER. It's about 4 o'clock. And I hear the ambulance pager go off. Beep, 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 beep. And it was like Westfield Hospital. We have a 16-year-old hit by a train. Okay, Westfield Hospital, Westfield Fire Department, we received the call. Stand by. So all of a sudden, I'm waiting by the radio. Okay, I have a 15-year-old. My older boy's 15 years old. So I'm like, in my mind, I'm like, there's no way they're transporting. There's no way, if someone gets hit by a train, they die. There's no way there's transport. So basically, I'm sitting by the radio, the two nurses come by, we're kind of listening. There's no way they're transporting. There's no way they're transporting. Please don't transport. There's no way they're transporting. Please don't transport. We're on scene. So I'm listening. Next thing you know, Westfield Hospital, we're transporting. Oh, shit. Okay, so now all of a sudden, they're bringing in a 15-year-old hit by a train. We're doing CPR. Okay, shit. So I'm gowned up, ready for trauma code. Gowned up, gloved up, and every part of me is so afraid I'm going to see my son. Okay, so I'm fragile. So as soon as the kid came in, he was big. He was way bigger than, he looked like a man. So I was like, okay, this doesn't look like my son. So bottom line is, we go in there and my sweetheart's doing CPR on this kid. Needle decompression. He's not viable. He's dead. He's got brain matter. He's dead. Okay, so bottom line is, we work him for 10 minutes. He's dead. I pronounce him. Okay. I leave the room. I got to tell mom. Okay. And then the EMS tells me what happened. So I don't know. So basically, apparently him and his mom got into a fight. He was sent to his room. He left his room and he went to hang out with a bunch of friends. The friends were by the road tracks. They decided to jump in front of a train. I don't believe he committed suicide. I just think he got hit by a train. I think he jumped and he got hit, but all the other kids went across. So all of a sudden, I'm waiting for mom to come in. I'm waiting for mom. I'm really fragile. So I'm looking towards the ambulance bay because she's going to come this way. Kids in the code room. So bottom line is, all of a sudden, mom doesn't show up, and it's a little bizarre. All of a sudden, one of the kids come in who witnesses, and he's screaming. He's just screaming. I can't deal with him. Put him over here. I got to tell mom. So he goes in our OB room, close the door. Nurses are dressing this. Another kid comes in screaming, piercing scream. I can't deal with this. I got to deal with mom. So they start putting the kids over here. There was three kids that come in screaming. 35 minutes, there's no mom. This makes no sense to me whatsoever. She has to know what happened. So all of a sudden the phone rings. The nurses are tied up taking care of patients. So I answer the phone, Westfield Hospital. They said, this is Hammett Trauma Center. It's almost like a perky triage nurse. Hey, this is Hammett Trauma Center. We have the mother here of the child who got hit by the train. Are you going to send him down? And I said, he died. And all of a sudden you hear, Oh, I'm going to send mom up. Okay, so now I got another half an hour. So I'm dealing with these kids screaming, kids over here. I can't deal with the kids yet. So mom comes in and I had to break the news to her that her kid died. Horrible, horrible. To hear her scream, oh, it still bothers me to this day. Horrible to walk her back. I made it a habit, Denny, whenever someone died and I'm pronouncing them, I'm gonna bring the family back. So I brought her back, she's distraught. Oh, still, okay, it was a horrible case. I got off the ship, I still hear it. That weekend, I took my kids to a hockey tournament in Canada, and I just couldn't stop, even now when I relive it. Oh, super powerful. I mean, I went to the kids' wake just because I had to cope. It bothered me so bad. When I came back to work, the nurse who I was on with, her name was Becky, we didn't get along well. And I said, Becky, I got to talk to you. And I said, because she was a nurse four times as long as I was a PA. And I said, on a scale from 1 to 10, how bad was this case for you? She goes, John, nothing was worse. That was the worst case. So we did go through some debriefing. It was horrible. And it was very humbling, okay? By God's grace, I didn't kill anybody and no one by me got hit. Thank God. I just know how much this case bothers me, even talking to you guys about it. It was a horrible case. I'll never forget it. And it was very humbling. Holy cow, it was such a bad case. Now I'm thankful that I went through it because it allowed me more depth as a clinician, but it was horrible. And then it just made me go how silly and mature I am. I can't know when people respond to combat, and my combat was nothing. I'm shooting at people long distance. I'm not close combat like some of the Fallujah guys. So just, it was very, very humbling. Cool.